the reason, I mean, the introduction of this W leads to a term here, which is the addition of W,
which comes up. We discuss, I mean, we'll see as we go through the slides. But somehow this
term here, it corresponds to working lower than that, right? So it's actually, in terms of what's happening here, you might also want to have a term involving psi squared, which would be like one of our squared. Okay. And that kind of derivation of W is connected with a lower order term. So this is connected with a lower order term. So what I want to say is that you can twist F such that this quantity has a good sign, or so this is the standard approach. And there is a Stogin approach. So this is a former student of mine, Stogin. He never wrote his paper, but he has a thesis which is done, where you pick up W instead first in order to make this positive. And then from it, you get the F, okay? But you need both, right? I mean, F in particular is clearly connected. You see, F is clearly connected with the trapping. So, because in fact, this F has to be generated exactly at the trapping. And so anyway, so there are, you should be aware that there are these two approaches. The nice thing about this approach of Stogin, so in fact, in what we did in this book, we use a Stogin's approach, okay? Which was not necessary. I mean, in fact, it makes it more complicated. So at least for stability of Schwarzschild or the stability of the kind of work you are trying to do for Reichen and Ostrom, I think the first approach is better. This is good. This approach is good if you want to do large A. Yeah, presumably. In fact, actually, what he does, he shows that at least in the case of the wave equation in Kerr, right? For the wave equation in Kerr, in axial symmetry, so if you assume also axial symmetry, then you can do the dark range effect. So the hope is that we can do this also without axial symmetry. Right? That has not been done, not through this method. There are other methods that do not fail. They don't generalize to perturbation. Right. So we want methods which obviously work not just in care, but also in care. Yeah, so the major new thing in the case of care, so the major new thing is that this Moravec estimate, the degeneracy, the Moravec estimate, the degeneracy is actually a problem. It's much more complicated. Okay. So in fact, it cannot be done by a vector field method. So one can show in fact that there is no vector field method that does the more of a system in the case of K. The degeneracy, you can see here, the degeneracy the tar equals 3n, right? So you can trap in the tar equals 3n. And the estimate is degenerate, right? Because what you are bounding is this term, R minus 3M. So in other words, exactly that equals 3M, this gives you no information about the state. Right? It gives you something for R different from 3M, but exactly that equals 3M degenerates. Now, in the case of care, the degeneracy, so this is something very special about Schwarzschild. Degeneracy occurs exactly the R equals 3M. No, in general, that's just not true. So for Kerr, you have a whole region in which you have degeneracy. So the whole region of R should have degeneracy. Okay, very good. So let's get now to the slides.
It doesn't look very well at all. Really. So is there anything one can do? Oh, this one. It doesn't.
Let's see, was she trying to do something?
Okay. Pilots, no. Contract, let me see. Try the extreme setting. It doesn't look.
Yeah, it isn't.
Ah, you could do it? Okay, so that should be better.
Yeah.
I'm trying this. Okay, let's see what I can do with the right.
No.
Okay, then I think I should change the focus on the suit. Okay, that's good now, I think, right?
Yeah.
Okay.
Oh, it makes sense.
Okay.
I think it's acceptable. Yes.
Okay. But this doesn't work. Okay.
It's going to be complicated like this. This doesn't, I don't see any movement here. Sorry?
Oh, you mean the...
Yeah.
And then now it should work.
Okay. It works, okay, good. All right, so let's go to from the beginning. Okay, so being more about that estimates care. So there is a model problem which is here. So this is the down version in care. So two here refers to the fact that we have a two horizontal form size, a two horizontal form, symmetric in fact. There is this term here that I mentioned at some point, that there is an additional term which doesn't play much of a, at least for small a. So at the first reading, you can just ignore it, okay? And then you have the potential, so V has a good sign. And then there is a nonlinear term and the inhomogeneous term. And of course, the inhomogeneous term has to play a major role when you really apply it to the nonlinear problem, right? So you cannot, if you just do this equal to zero, you know, later on, you're not able to apply it to anything. Right, so you actually have to do the inhomogeneous term. The V is given by this expression. So delta in this case is the delta of the horizon, right?
Even though I wonder, you know, in the VHFT, is the domain of the reader should be shared.
Yes.
Without the same measures. They must have the equation for care, right? I mean, and then through the.
Oh, you mean this term? No.
No, I don't know because I mean, I know the estimates there are in physical space, so it's all on its usual here. But since you don't know, I mean, I mean, everything that appears with an A is in the zero terms, even though, you know, it's maybe that's something like that, but that's something that is.
Basically, they don't have that term,
they
just assume.
How can they not have it? It's, you know, the short term.
By the way, it's not a general perspective. I mean, they make it very clear. It's not a general perspective.
Yeah, I mean, it has.
They have solved it in the earth, then? It doesn't make much sense.
They have assumption. In the end, it has to be zero because the moment you have a little bit of A,
yeah,
you,
the more of a system it doesn't work.
But they have the assumption that maybe something like F1 divided by the largest.
Oh.
And then at the end, it goes with good.
So you pick up zero. Like, oh, okay.
A becomes zero only at the end.
Okay. Okay. Yeah.
So A is not zero in the process of the guesses, even though it's everything
in the end physical,
is physical space and everything. So it's done effectively, it's done Schwarzschild. So, for example, like Moravitz block, it's 1 minus 3 M over R. I mean, it's written like 1 minus R and so on. But they still have these terms of error. But at least what we.
Yeah, but it's an error term which at the end goes to zero.
Yeah.
This one here?
Yeah, because A is something like epsilon, and C is epsilon.
Okay.
Okay.
Okay, so the difference is whether it's like an F. It's so it's a really like a boost, so it's an F. But see, but even being epsilon square, it doesn't seem that obvious. I mean, it's still a quadratic term.
Yeah, no, I mean, one has to understand what they are doing. I never dare to read that. I looked only in the introduction, I must say. And I was already upset with the introductions. Anyway, but it obviously has interesting things there. Okay, so so what do I want to say? Right. So this is think of it. I mean, you can forget about this in the first approximation. It plays actually a role in the energy estimate. When you do the energy estimate, it is actually important. But for the moment, let's forget about it. And then we have regions of integrations, right? So you want to do something very similar like here. In fact, it's more or less the same picture. You want to introduce a time function. They will have a horizon. The horizon is not equal to 2m, but there is a horizon. And you also want to integrate between these two regions. So this would be your m. Okay, so here's the Kerr solution. And there is this definition of the trapping and the region of trapping, where tau, the important thing is what tau is. So tau is this polynomial. It's r cubed minus 3 r squared plus a squared r plus m a squared. So for those of you who have looked at how you derive the equations for the null geodesics in Kerr, you see that already appears there, okay? So anyway, this is what it is. So this is a non-trapping region, it's just a complement. The redshift, there is also a redshift, yeah, which I should have said here already. Whenever we do the estimates in Schwarzschild and also in Kerr, the first estimates that you do are also degenerate at r equal to 2m. In other words, you don't get good information at r equal to 2m. So the way around it is to combine, in addition to what I wrote here, you also have to do the, what are called redshift estimates. So these are estimates done exactly, so this would be estimates which are done in a very small neighborhood, r equal to 2m, where you use the fact that the surface gravity as a sign, the negative something else. Okay, so that plays a very important role. That gives you something exponential decay. So it gives you a very good. The redshift really helps you quite a lot, and you get rid of the degeneracy. But of course, you also have to use whenever you prove the redshift estimates, you have to integrate in regions like this, which are not causal, right? So, which means that, say, for example, you generate a boundary term, but the boundary term, you estimate it in terms of the Moravec estimate. So, the degenerate Moravec estimate takes care of the term, which you do in order to do the very cheap. So you really have to have also very cheap. Not, of course, in Minkowski space, there is no need, but there is a need on black box. Okay, so this is a redshift region. So here is a domain n tau 1 tau 2. It's a region of M where tau is less than tau 1 less than tau 2. So what is a tau? Is a function which is defined in some lemma. Forget about it for the moment. It's not important. Tau doesn't play a very important role. Of course, when you want to put everything together, you have to be very clear about what tau is. But think of it as just being a time-like surface, right? So you have the tau being a time function. So it's a space-like surface. And the important thing to keep in mind, and this was sort of always a little confusing, because we always thought that when we do this kind of integrals, Moravec or energy estimates, that you want this tau function to be connected to the foliation. But you don't need it. And the reason you don't need it is because the only information you need about the tau function is a normal to tau, nothing else, right? You don't need higher derivatives of tau.
So if you need it, so if you use the tau function to be part of the foliation, expressed in terms of the foliation, it looks like you need derivatives of it also, right? Because the foliation is being used in the arguments and it's all derivatives of it. But in reality, you have a lot of freedom. So again, the important thing is that you have freedom, a lot of freedom in choosing the tau function. It doesn't have to be connected to the foliation.
Okay, it's something much more.
Sorry?
What?
It's not so good anymore, no?
I just
do
S.
S?
Just put it like
escape.
Control S? Or S? I don't know.
Anybody knows what to do?
Just put it full screen.
Ah.
Okay, that's better. Okay. Thanks. Right. So delta red is some small constant which is connected. So this has something to do. Yeah. Again, this is an important thing to say. If A is exactly equal to M, right? Then there is no the redshift region becomes zero. So the smallness of this region is connected with the distance between A and M. So A over M should be strictly less than one. If A and M becomes equal to one, there is no, we don't have any freedom here. There is no redshift effect anymore, okay? But for A sufficiently small, clearly you have a sufficiently large region. Okay, so.
Sorry. Okay, so this is
the fact that T is the time translation in Kerr, right? So you see that GDT, if you calculate from the Kerr values, you get this expression. And you see this expression can become, normally this should be negative, but it can become positive, and this is exactly the ergo region. So the other thing that you have here is the ergo region. The ergo region, in principle, looks like it's an immense problem. And actually, it is a big problem for large A, but for small A, it's not a big problem. And the reason is, first of all, you can see that GTC is negative if R is sufficiently large. For A, M sufficiently small, I think that you can strictly time like in M trap. So this is important. So the trapping region separates from the region of the ergo region. So this is again something that I mentioned in advance, but I'll mention it again. So there is a in Kerr, there is a whole region which is around R equal to 3 if you want, if A sufficiently small. So whatever is sufficiently small. So there is such a region, but there is also a region of the ergo region where the ergo region is present. And you want these two things to be disjoint, right? So you again, you can make it disjoint if A is sufficient. Right. Okay. Here is a. Here is a vector field with which we actually. Which you actually use for the energy estimate. You want a vector, because of the ergo region, you don't want to use this one. I mean, this would be natural to use for the energy, but you don't want to use it because it leads to something negative. So what you do is that you change it, but you change it everywhere except in the trapping. So you want to, in the trapping, you want, so you, in other words, T delta is exactly T near the trapping, but in the ergo region, it becomes something different, and in particular, it's going to be time lapse. Okay, so that's so this is simple observation, but I'm just telling you why is it important. So this is anyway the start of you can figure it out what they are. It's not a big deal. Okay, so now let's talk about the main norms. Let's start with the Moravec norm, because these are somehow the most important because of the degeneracy. So the Moravec in Kerr is defined by some in this tau 1, tau 2, which I talked about, so it's all this region. And there is a this dr hat. By the way, what is dr hat? I guess it doesn't show up here. But this is done in the chapter on Kerr. So in chapter of Kerr, we define from T and D over DR. So if you think D over DR is not naturally defined in Kerr, you can define so called T hat and R hat. So T hat is a combination of these three and four. So both are a combination of these three and four. But one is a combination that looks like D over DR. And the other one was like the over right. But it's such that T hat. You know, I don't dare to go back to that cab and to come back. But...
Maybe. Is it? Do you guys know what it is, or shall I really refresh your memory? We discussed it at some point. But... Okay, let's go back. So this is on Kerr. Complex notations. Okay. So this is in Kerr, various notations. Oh, sorry, this is something else, it's not Kerr. Sorry, I don't understand what's wrong. Yeah, okay, the Kerr spacetime. Okay, so the Kerr spacetime, yeah, so you have, again, you have the T and the Z, you have this GTT that we saw. Okay, and you have now the definition of T hat. So T hat is D over DT plus a term proportional to D over D phi. And R hat is a reparameterized D over DR, right? So the important thing is that when you do it like this, GT hat, T hat becomes time-like everywhere except on the horizon. It still vanishes on the horizon. Well, GR hat behaves in the way you want. Okay, so that's basically, I mean, that's what I wanted to say. So, of course, T hat delta is also different from T hat. I mean, it is connected with T hat, but it's different because it has to be exactly T in the trapping region. Okay, so let's go back now. Where is it? No, I have to go back. Okay, so this is where we were. Main norms. Okay.
Okay, so this is the Moravitz estimate. So R hat looks like a D over DR, as I just said. But it's a normalized one. And there are this power so far. Again, the R is just the R of Kerr. You can find, so this is a technical thing which plays a role at some point, that you want also a slightly stronger norm, which has an R to the minus one minus delta. So you see these three cancels out as a minus two. But in reality, by working a little bit harder, you can get also an estimate for R to the minus one minus delta. And that's important. Okay.
But anyway, this is a technicality at this stage. The flux norms.
So this is A. and the picture is this is the horizon, and this is the apparent horizon. And you go into the so this is the parting. I will page the horizon. Then somewhere here, it's also the region of the body. Okay. So, okay. So, so F is a flux, and it's defined like this. It's a flux on A. By the way, sigma star, I have to say also something about sigma star. So, sigma star. It's a last slice, right? So of course, if you work in Kerr, you can go all the way to infinity, but in perturbations, you don't know what the infinity is, and you go all the way to sigma star, and sigma star being the last slice at GCM higher surface. You want to define fluxes through those hypersurfaces, and as you see, the fluxes are very simple, are very natural. I mean, there is a D4, a D3, and algebra derivatives. They all come up in the same way. And the lower the term says an algebra minus 2. And the flux on sigma star is, okay. Then there are the N norms. So these are the norms that you need for the right-hand side. Yes. This in a first approximation, you can just ignore them. Maybe there is one thing to be seen here that it's important is that the certain terms are defined in terms of absolute values, right? That you see here, absolute values, but this one is not. Okay, the reason is because you'll have to do actually an integration by parts. So when this type of terms, if you try to put absolute values here, you will miss something important, okay? So but otherwise, these norms come naturally when you do the estimates. Okay, so and then there are some the weighted bulk norms, where you put weighted norms. So these are the ways which are the RP weighted estimates. Which will be done at some point. So for the moment, you can ignore. So right now, we want to concentrate just on more of it. But of course, this will also play an important role. There are also weighted flux norms. Okay, and then there are combined norms, where you put all these things together. So you take B, E, F, E. So B from bulk, E from energy, F from flux, B, F, E of psi is an energy norm. A supremum over tau between tau 1 and tau 2, right? This is here. BP, so this is the whole bulk integration. And FP is a flux, right? Here and here. Okay, so, you also have just the energy and the flux norms, which are on the right side. Weighted N norms, again, this is inhomogeneity, so we can ignore. Then you can have higher order norms where you start putting derivatives. So basically, they are very simple. This is very simple to define. You just take a given norm, one of the 10 norms that we had before, and you take QS. So S is one number of derivatives, and you put here dk of psi. So dk, I recall, d of psi. All right, just d psi. This is R before R angular. And just this screen does not include the usual thing that happens for the wave equation. Okay, so
all right. So let's go now to the norms, the main norms for the.
Okay, so this is the main result, which is that. Contains all the RP weighted estimates,
particularly in other words, it contains both Moravets and energy and RP weighted, all put together, and redshift, by the way. There is also the redshift.
They're all put together in this estimate, right? So this is again, DEF, right? So all the combination of these three nodes on the left hand side is less than the energy at tau 1. So you have tau 1 and tau 2. So tau 2 is bigger than tau 1, right? So it's a bad indeed wrong here. It should be tau 2. So you have to think about this tau 1 as being the initial data. It's not really the initial data. It's actually, it's important to keep this tau 1, not to fix it, because you need it later on when you do the decay. Right? So it's important to actually have something between two different values of tau. Right? So
this is the estimate. There is a stronger estimate, which we call side check.
Again, this has to do for the moment. Again, it's
not important. It's important only later on. So let me go very fast over this. But anyway, there is a second theorem, it's called the improved RP weighted estimates.
So let's not spend time on this, and let's go instead to the main Moravec estimates. So main Moravec energy results. So these are the ones that I want to talk about today. So
this is a combination of Moravec and energy in the full A less than M. But it's not like, it's A over M sufficiently small, right? But it's in Kerr. And it's a BEF norms of all the derivatives up to derivatives of all the S, right? So D3, D4. Actually, what's interesting here is that you are treating D3 and D4 in the same manner. While here, you see, you have an RE4. So somehow, this is a weaker estimate than what you expect, but it's important to be that way from a technical reasons. So it's estimated in terms of an energy at time tau 1, right? So this is here. Then something nonlinear, something from the inhomogeneous term. And then there is an error term, which is of the type, as you see here, it's A over M plus epsilon. And there is the BEF delta S of psi and tau 1, tau 2. So you see there is a delta here, which is kind of funny. It just tells you that you cannot close the estimate at this level. In order to close this estimate, you need to do also RP type west because delta corresponds to a P, right?
So this is one of relatively important technical details
that you cannot quite close at this level. You have to go at this level.
I'm curious how it is done in DHRT, but there they have more decay. I mean, one has to be careful because, you know, people always say that DHRT is more general, but in reality, they use more decay. Right, and some of these subtleties may not show up at all, but it would be interesting. So if you look at the work, please take a look at that too, right?
So again, I mean, you understand the point, right? That there is the error terms involves a higher RP weight, right? So you're not, in principle, you cannot close until you also have a delta here, but you will have it later on when you do the RP weighted estimate, you will have that delta. And then this term is sufficiently small, you'll be able to close it on the, right? You know, you'll be able to absorb it on the left. I'm sorry?
They may still need to update.
I'm curious, yeah. I'm curious. Okay. I'm sorry?
Why 11 sometimes?
Yeah, this is the same order of derivative. It's important. Right?
Just the dead.
Sorry?
Yeah. And what you asked?
I'm not my loss of derivative.
No, there is no
look.
Yeah, no, it's written in such, I mean, the definition, you see the BEF comes, I mean, we can look back at the definition of B, right? A BEFS. Yeah, so,
This one, where is this? It's here, right? Main Morawis. This one, right?
Yeah, so you see there are S derivative. So there are S derivative, but BF contains one derivative. So this is like S plus one derivative, and this is also like S plus one derivative. So it's the same level of derivatives.
I'm asking for the M derivative on the right.
This one?
Yeah.
So it's the same thing. It's when you said ES, so E corresponds to one derivative, and ES corresponds to S plus one. Right? Okay, so this is sort of the main more or less estimate that you have to prove in Kerr. Okay, and then there are these additional energy flux and bulk, which are actually more precise. Okay, so this is a
statement that I can make right now about how the proof of energy more or less estimate work in Kerr. Okay.
So as I said, you cannot have a vector field method.
So what you do instead, you start with your equation. Maybe we should write the equation again. Forget about that. There is an extra term, but let's forget it for a moment. Let's assume it should be a minus here. But let's assume that this is the problem that you have, then on the right hand side. The usual more or less estimates are done using this method with S is F times PR. But this, as I said, is not going to work. So instead, what works is that you commute first to the Carter operator. In fact, we commute to this operator, which we call O, if you remember, right? O. Was like Q squared times this is all anyway, it's a second order. Let me get about this one. It's a second order of it. Well, always is something which was generated on the Carter tensor. So it's in other words, you are committing with a second order operator, so this psi a. Actually, sorry, excuse me. It's not just a second order operator. You are commuting with operators which are formed in PP, PZ, and O. Okay, so these are all second order operators. Okay, so you are computing here with a second order operator, and A stands. This would be A equal to zero, this would be A equal to one, this would be A equal to two, and this would be A equal to zero. So it stands for the indices 0, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10, 11, 12, 13, 14, 15, 16, 17, 18, 19, 20. Okay? So what you get here is now a system of wave equations for each A, right? So there are four equations for what you can think of being as four unknowns. I mean, it's unknown, but in reality, psi A is derived from the psi for a commutative, right? So the idea of the, okay, so you see psi A is SA of psi, SA being exactly this operator. Well, actually they are written here. There is a S1 is dt, S2 is A dt, right? And then S3, which is A squared dz dz, and S4, which is all psi. Okay, so psi A are exactly SA of that for A between 1 and 2 and 3, 4. Okay, so here are some notations. Okay. There are some, okay, so there are also additional notations. This is something that has to do with this degeneracy that I talked about before. You see in the main estimates, in the main results, at the end of the day, you don't have this degeneracy. But as I mentioned earlier, when you prove the Moravec estimates, in the first step, you'll have degeneracy. It's only later on when you use redshift that you get rid of it, right? So, okay, so then here I refine Moravec's norm. So these are the norms that you actually will control. And from them, you see, you'll have estimates for this type of norms, and from them, you derive the estimates which we had earlier, okay, which were, anyway, the ones which we defined already. Okay, it's tough to go back and forth. Okay, anyway, so these are the only new thing here is that, there's more to be said. So these are the refined norms, but these are so-called degenerate axially symmetric Moravec norm. In other words, these are norms which will be used for studying axially symmetric solutions of the wave equation, right? Okay, so you see, you have a sum. So what's remarkable here is that you have a sum of square which degenerates, this tau becomes zero in the trapping. But it degenerates just the tau equal zero, nothing else, right? And this is typical to axially symmetric case, right? In the general case, you can't have this. And you see again something positive, but you have degeneracy for these terms. And there is also, this is a dot norm and this is a non dot norm. The difference is that you have also lower the term here, okay? Right. So you have one which is the dark with all the lower term and the one below it. Okay, now here the more interesting norms are the one which are needed in the general case when you don't have axial symmetry. And the crucial terms here are these ones, the capital psi. You see, you have a square. I mean, you want to have a sum of square, right? Otherwise, it's not a norm. Right, so you want to have a sum of square, but the sum of square is defined in terms of a complicated quantity, which is a capital psi of c. Capital psi of c here, okay. And then there is also the degenerate one. Well, it's degenerate by definition, but this is a dot norm and this is the non dot norm in the sense that you also have slower than that. The S norms were defined earlier. Let's go back a little bit. So this is a
pointwise notation. It's right. Sorry, it doesn't work. Mm-hmm. Yeah. So you see the S norms, given a psi A, given a psi, you define the dy of psi or just psi. Yeah, this one. Sorry. You define this term as being the sum of the say I squared, where the A are the correspond to these commutations with a second order operators, right? Okay, so notation is quite easy, but I don't know. Okay. All right, so now I need to tell you about this psi, right? So see, psi, you can see here, you start with the psi A, so which were the actual, you can say, unknowns, which are obtained by computation with a second order operator. But then it's a linear combination. See, A runs from one to four. So this is actually a linear combination of the psi, right? And it's this that comes up here, right? So you're actually estimating a squared, but the square itself is a sum of terms. So you cannot really estimate any of the terms inside. You only have an estimate for the whole thing, right?
So of course, so this is
the remarkable feature of this Anderson-Bloom method, which we apply.
Okay, and the question is, you want to ask what are these terms here, okay? So the RA is defined. So this is R1, R2, R3, R4. So they come naturally from the 337, I think.
Let's see, what was 337?
Go to page one. We need to go back.
You want to see? They
okay, I think we should go, but this was important. It's done before, actually. Yeah, here, you can see it here, okay. So
it comes from this decompositions of the inverse magic. So the magic in care had this remarkable decomposition into a part which is just dr dr and the term which is 1 over delta, and this is r alpha beta. R alpha beta being the second order operator. I mean, it's a tensor now. It's a tensor dt alpha dt beta. And so you recognize here exactly the combination that we are interested in, since the whole. In other words, you can see here, again, R alpha beta is a combination of this term, which is exactly corresponding to what we call S1, right? This corresponds to S2, this corresponds to S3, and this corresponds to S4, right?
So that's where...
So the definition of this coefficients come from here. So whatever we saw there comes from this, right?
Is that clear?
Right. Okay, so let's go back. If we can, what was this? Okay, I think we were just about right. Okay. All right.
Yeah, okay, so these are exactly these coefficients.
Okay, so there is a prime here, but the prime is derived from RA by differentiating C over delta. So these are the function that you have to find. So it's something that comes up into the proof. So it's something that is going to be given. And the RA are defined exactly like this in terms of
the decomposition of the inverse metric. Okay, so.
So there are lots of remarks to make here. In particular, the structure of this psi z, right? So
it's the psi
z that I said it's a sum of terms, right? It's exactly this one. Here it's written a little bit in more details how it looks like. It's a combination of S1 and O. And then plus these other terms, which are a little bit better somehow because you can take them outside the psi z. Sorry, yeah, no, sorry. There is something which is trapped here. But the whole thing is trapped anyway, because you have a sum of terms, and it's a sum of terms which is being squared. So you
cannot derive particular estimates for any of these terms directly. However, if you are away from trapping,
this is written here. So you see it says, this type of norms involve a sum of positive terms, each of which is given in terms of a linear combination of derivatives of psi, right? That's what we saw. In order to bound them by a sum of positive terms involving psi directly, one is to have a full degeneracy in the trapping region here for small a over n. This means in the non-trapping region. So then the important point here is that if I'm not trapped, then I can write whatever I had before in terms of sum of squares, right? But again, this type of term is only occurs in the non-trapping region. Is that clear?
Right. I mean, this is a crucial thing, right? So, how do you derive the type of estimate that we want?
Remember that the estimates we wanted in the moral estimate. We had more of this. We had an integral n of tau 1, tau 2. And there was in the was something non-trivial. So in the non-trapping region, we could estimate both in and under the nuclear side squared and under the nuclear side squared, but only in the non-trapped region. And of course, you had plus this other terms, which was dr, this dr pocket from size squared, which also came up with some term here, but it was not trapped, right? So this was the structure of the final estimate, but this final estimate is derived, in fact, from this, right? By observing that away from traveling,
you get this type of expression that you can estimate
reasoning in terms of this type of norms, which are the norms that you want. Okay, so in particular. What is said here is that you get an estimate.
So from the Moravec estimate involving this complicated psi z, right, you get this type of estimate,
which is what you want. In other words, this was exactly the norm that we call more. Okay, so you get an estimate for the more in terms of whatever you have on the right side.
It's complicated, but something. I'm sorry.
You mean this terms here, this lower the terms here?
No, at the end you want to keep in the trap region.
You mean this one here?
Yeah.
But you have the DT and algebra. Oh, there is no trapping anymore. You forget about trapping. So.
Yeah, I mean, you can use the zero all the time
too. Oh yeah, right. Later on, in the way they are being used. Yeah, you're right. I mean, this estimates more don't tell you anything about the traveling region. So you're asking a very good question. So if you are exactly in the traveling, this estimates don't tell you anything. But you get something from the lower data.
So instead of having a factor that matters to the traffic surface, we just throw away the traffic.
Yes, you're right. Yeah, so let's go back and actually see, this is an important question. So let's go back.
Well, it's wondering why in the wall it's not as low.
Yeah, of course. Yeah, you're absolutely right. It's a good question. So let's go back to the definition of the, sorry, what is it? This one, right? The main norms. Okay, so so in the main norms, you see,
you have this one only in the non-trapping region. So you take away. So if you have no information in the trapping region for these derivatives, you have this derivative everywhere, and you have the lower order term, right? So it's crucial to get the lower order. If without the lower order term, you'll have problems.
It's essentially the
Yes, right. It's going to use the version of W, right? Indeed. And hard estimates. Right. But of course, that means that in this scheme, it automatically lose a derivative. Mm-hmm. Because you are never, I mean, this doesn't give the estimate in the trapping region of this quantity. So the only way to get it is using this by going one extra derivative, right? So you lose a derivative. Yeah, so this scheme loses automatically a derivative.
All right. Okay. Okay, so outline of the proof of theorem 431. So what is, so this 431 is more of its energy, okay. Okay, so that's okay. So as you see, we first derive
uh,
degenerate conditional moralizers. Degenerate means again, like always, is a you
have something bad. Oh, it's already for God, I'm going so slow. Okay, I apologize. This is very slow. Let me at least go very fast over what I wanted to say. Maybe it's
better to say on the whole directly. Okay, so here's how it goes. You start with conditional estimates, which are interesting in their own right. The conditional estimate apply in particular to the case where you have axioms matching solution. So what this means is that whenever you do the estimates for more density, you see
here that there are these two type of conditional estimates. So here is the norm. Here, if you remember, this was a norm which has a trapping, that tau equals zero exactly, right? So this is a norm very similar to the norms that we get in Schwarzschild. Okay. But on the right hand side, you have this term M of psi, which is the term that is going to be estimated by the energy, right? So this is something that you will have to combine later on with the energy in order to get rid of this term. And then you see the conditional part. The conditional part is in order to estimate this term, I have to know estimates for this term, which in principle I don't have, right? I mean, this is something that I have to prove. So here is something that depends on dz. So if dz of psi is zero, and so if psi is actually symmetric, then you win. You don't have this term, and you have only the lower order term. Okay, and forget about this one because it's inhomogeneous. And there is a second estimate, which
it doesn't have the dot, which means I'm allowing on the left hand side, I'm allowing the term in psi squared, the lower the term. Okay. And then you have on the right hand side, you have this AR minus one, arguably the psi plus R minus two dt of psi. So these are estimates that I don't have. Okay. However, you can see here that if A was zero, I would be exactly in Schwarzschild. But then this term is not present, and then you get the usual negative. So one of the nice things about the way it's proved here, these things are proved, is that you can see how Schwarzschild fits into the general context, right? So this, of course, is much easier to prove than the estimates in Kerr, right? But they are important also in Kerr because
somehow.
Later on,
well, actually, I don't need this one.
I don't know how to do these ones, but I know how to do the estimates which involve the commutations with the Carter operators, which are at the higher level of derivatives, right? And then somehow these terms will be absorbed in the high derivative terms that come from commutations with the Carter operators. So that's basically the idea. So that's how. So you need both. You need these terms, but you also need the pattern. And again, these are much easier to prove, and it's a very good, I mean, for everybody who wants to learn this stuff, that's the first thing to do these conditional estimates,
because they already give you a very good sense of what's going on. And then the second part, and we'll do it next week is Thanksgiving, I guess, right? So 2 weeks from now, and that will be the last lecture, we'll do the Moravec's estimating Kerr. That would be it. Okay.